Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to Emmanuel Lutheran Church members of the Evangelical Lutheran Synod on this Sexagesima Sunday. And our theme for today is, He Who Has Ears, Let Him Hear. And we begin with our first.
To the end.
that by thy grace we may come to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, our heavenly Father, hath had mercy upon us, and has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. To them that believe on his name, he hath given the power to become the sons of God, and has promised them his Holy Spirit. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, Lord, unto us all. We join in the Psalm of the Day, Psalm 44, and it's printed in your bulletins, and we read that responsibly. We have heard it with our ears, O God. With your hand you drove out the nations and planted our ancestors.
It was not by their sword that they won the land. It was your right hand and the light of your face, for you love them.
You are my King and my God, who decrees victories for Jacob.
I put no trust in my hope, but you give us victory over our enemies.
In God we make our boast all day long, and we will praise your name forever.
But now you have rejected and humbled us. You made us retreat before the enemy, and our adversaries have plundered us.
You have made us a reproach to our neighbors, the scorn and discretion of those around us.
All of us came upon us. Our hearts have not turned back. Our feet have not strayed from your path.
If we have forgotten the name of our God, or spread out our hands to a foreign God, would not God have discovered it, since he knows the secrets of our heart?
Yet for your sake, we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered.
Awake, Lord. Why do you sleep? Rouse yourself. Do not reject us forever.
Why lie you on your face and forgive us
our transgressions? Rise up and help us. Rescue us because of your unfailing love.
Thank you.
us to put not our trust in anything we do, but in Him alone. Mercifully grant that by Thy power we may be defended against all adversities, through Jesus Christ, Thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with Thee and the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end. Self-seeking, self-trust, and self-righteousness will taunt or taint our sacrifice and render it unacceptable. For the sacrifice must be offered to God. The sower and the seed brings us into contact with the soil. This is where the growth depends upon the soil. And the church reminds us so urgently that the human race groans under the burden of sin, yet the power of grace reaches its fullness in the weakness of our inherited sinfulness and perishes because of it. Yet in spite of our sinfulness, we continue to grow in grace. In our first lesson, Isaiah's prophecy is a beautiful promise of God that His word will always bring forth fruit to its hearers, spiritual fruit that endures through all eternity. Our first lesson is from the Old Testament reading of Isaiah 55, verses 10 through 13. As the rain and snow come down from heaven, and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes out of my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. You will go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and hills will burst forth into song before you, and all the trees of the fields will clap their hands. Instead of thorn bush will grow the pine tree, and instead of briars the myrtle will grow. This will be for the Lord's renown, for the everlasting sign, which will not be destroyed. Here endeth our first reading, and we join in the confessional reading, and this is the Augsburg Confession, part 4, about justification. Therefore, when a man believes that his sins are forgiven because of Christ, and that God is reconciled and favorable disposed to him because of Christ, this personal faith obtains the forgiveness of sins and justifies us. In pain and terrors of conscience, it consoles and encourages our hearts. Thus, it regenerates us and brings us the Holy Spirit so that we can finally obey God's law, love Him, truly fear Him, be sure that He hears us, and obey Him in all afflictions. It mortifies our lust by freely accepting the forgiveness of sins. Faith sets against God's wrath, not our merits of love, but Christ, the mediator and propitiator. This faith is the true knowledge of sin. It uses His blessings. It regenerates our hearts. It proceeds our keeping of the law. And that ends our meeting. Our epistle lesson then is that the fellowship with God is none other than where we try to find, to understand, and achieve that goal sometimes on our own. But God Himself supplies us this through the crucified Messiah, Jesus.
On the cross, Christ completed his life of obedience that we now call our own. He accepted the punishment for our rebellion and ended that separation between us and God. The cross was, in fact, God's ultimate demonstration of his wisdom and power. For only Christ crucified does God recapture the throne of our hearts. The epistle lesson for this Sexagesima Sunday, meaning none other than the second Sunday before Ash Wednesday, is written in the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 1, verses 20 through 25. Where is the wise person? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know him. God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. Jews demand signs and Greeks look for wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to the Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jew and Greek, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. Here endeth the epistle lesson. We join in the gradual Alleluia. We have heard with our ears, O Lord. Our fathers have told us what deeds you did in their days. It does not grow or multiply, but it is like dead. By itself, it is not alive, yet it has the power to live within it. It finds the right soil, and the dormant power of life becomes alive. The seed becomes a plant with leaves and flowers and fruit. In the gospel lesson, the seed is a picture of grace. Our Lord compares the Word to the seed. In it slumbers the God-filled life of grace and the inward power of life. And when men reject it and refuse it, refuse the entrance into their heart, it will not grow. The Holy Gospel is written in the 8th chapter of St. Luke, reading verses 4 through 15. Please rise for the reading. From town after town, he told this parable. A farmer went out to sow his seed, and as he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path. It was trampled on, and the birds of the air ate it up. Some fell on rock, and when it came up, the plants withered because they had no moisture. Other seeds fell among the thorns, which grew up with it and choked the plants. Still other seeds fell on good soil. It came up and yielded a crop 100 times more than was sown. And when he said this, he called out, "He who has ears, let him hear." His disciples asked him what this parable meant. He said, "The knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of God has been given to you, but to others I speak in parables, so that though seeing, they may not see, though hearing, they may not understand." This is the meaning of the parable. The seed is the word of God. Those along the path are the ones who hear, and then the devil comes and takes away the word from their hearts, so that they may not believe and be saved. Those on the rock are the ones who receive the word with joy when they hear it. but they have no root. They believe for a while, but in the time of testing, they fall away. The seed that fell among the thorns stands for those who hear, but as they go on their way and are choked by life's worries, riches, and pleasures, they do not mature. But the seed on the good soil stands for those with a noble and good heart, who hear the word, retain it, and by persevering, produce a crop. Here endeth the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let us confess our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed found on page 12. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated for our next hymn. Things he cried, he who has ears, let him hear. O Lord, sanctify us by your truth. Your word is truth. Amen. In our parable today, they all heard God's word. Yet only the fourth group keeps it and brings forth fruit. We should be very careful in the study of this gospel, so that each of us may examine ourselves to determine of which group we belong. We at times can belong to all of them, but hopefully we belong among those who come out of the good soil, among whom the word bears fruit. Dear fellow Redeemed, those that belong to the first group, the Lord says, are like the seed that fell on the road. It does not bear fruit because it is trampled or eaten by the birds. Those belonging to the second group are people who hear the word and believe it, growing quickly like seed that falls on stony soil. But as soon as the hot summer day comes along, the plant withers, since it neither has roots or moisture. At first, the word is precious to these people, but when trial and persecution comes, to endure a little suffering, they quickly fall away. Those that belong to the third group are the most easy for us to recognize. They are the Christians who are like the seed that falls among thorns, and even though they grow vigorously at first, it fails to come to maturity because it is choked by the thorns. And the fourth group are those who come to maturity because they received and kept the word until it brings forth fruits with patience. These are the righteous. They are the children of God who suffer for the sake of the word, who are very faithful and obedient servants of God, and show their love to their neighbor. Now this first class of disciples hear the word without benefit or fruit. But particularly troubling are those who belong to this first class. Often are of these, the Lord says, then the devil comes and takes away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. This is a verdict upon people, both young and old, who hear the word preach, but they walk away as though they had never heard it. They think that nothing is lost when they let the word in one ear and out the other. But the devil is their master. He controls their lives. He reaches into their hearts and plucks out that word. And when you and I meet such a person and have the opportunity to tell them about Jesus, we too may conclude that none other than the devil is in control of their heart, for he does not allow the good things they hear to enter the heart. They do not believe and cannot be saved. The other two groups are not quite so wicked. They are weak. In the beginning, they take note of some things. They even start to believe. And for this reason, the Lord does not give them entirely over to the devil, as he did the first class, even though they do not believe. As the second group, seeds fall on rocky places. As soon as the seeds spring up, the tender plants wither away because they lack moisture. And this second group then is composed of those who do not persevere under persecution because they have no roots. For a while they believe, but as soon as tribulation comes along, they grow terrified and are unwilling to endure suffering. And as a result, the fruit of eternal life will also remain beyond their reach, along with all other fruits that proceed from the word and faith. The third group is where the seed grows with a promise start. because it hears the word, yet because they neglect the word, and great cares and pleasures of this life then take it away. For whoever is obsessed by worldly cares has the word choked from them. The seed is then among the thorns. They are concerned more with temporal cares, with money and possessions, and these are the thorns that choke out the word of God in their hearts. They cannot grow and bear fruit. For this group, the word has no effect. This is a great and frightful loss that the heart cannot fully comprehend. Of all the warnings that this parable provides for us, this is very important. Here Christ is talking about the word of God. Those who have it in their hearts will be saved. Those who do not will be condemned. And when you and I meet temptations and the people who bring them to us, they come to us in ways which we can never even imagine. As we face temptations, then it often brings to us new responsibilities. And it is good for us at times to accept them and fulfill them. But with those responsibilities also comes temptations that become an overburden to us and the cares of this life. As each of us mature, we begin to become so overwhelmed that we forget the one thing needful. Then those responsibilities, as good as they may have been on their own, will become weeds that need to be plucked out of our lives. And if the weeds are not pulled out, they will gradually choke and kill our faith. Don't let the cares of this world become so great in your lives that your faith suffocates and dies. This is not a trifle matter. For it does no good for a person to think that they would like to be interested, to think that they shall study God's word and believe it after they have tried all other options, after they have accumulated all things that they consider important. But the Lord says, take care. Do not deceive yourself. We ask our Lord then to keep us among those who belong to the fourth group. Also earnestly praying that we may keep God's word, that we bring forth good fruit, that we are saints who hear the word, and the Holy Spirit brings forth fruit 100-fold that is bountiful beyond all measure. Although people calling and their offices and their fruits are all different, yet all are Christians, all are redeemed from sin and death through Christ, and are heirs of eternal life. And as children of God, we have that good and honest heart that really is intent on God's word. Such a heart must, above all else, then be faithful if the devil is not to come and snatch that word away from us. Second, the heart must then be firm and steadfast, allowing itself neither to be led astray nor be swayed by other people. As the first commandment tells us, fear and love God above all things. By keeping his word, it helps us to fight against this constant attack of the devil, that we and the devil cannot tolerate God's word. Third, the heart must be swept clean so that no thorns remain. We must not let the love of possessions, money, or pleasures come before God's word in our lives, nor let earthly matters be there. There the heart is steadfast. It must be swept clean. There we find a heart that produces good fruit without fail and with patience. And to be sure, trial and tribulation will come our way. Adversity and temptation will not be lacking in our lives as we are assaulted in all ways by the devil. For the devil tries many ways to take the word away from us. He burdens us with cares, with greed, with pride, with anger, and all kinds of other mischief. So we need to be on guard against the weakness and infirmities of our lives, against false securities that we place there. We ask God for His Holy Spirit to remove such obstacles, to sweep out the thorns and thistles of our heart. Only then can we continue to hear and keep God's word, bring forth good fruit, faith in Christ, through which faith also becomes God's children and heirs. Now, the main reason that seed is sown is that the gospel be proclaimed throughout all world. It is created to work faith in us that will endure through all eternity. In this parable, we see that the word does not bring forth fruit in every case. Yet the fault does not lie in the word, nor the one who preaches it. When Christ and his apostles preached, there were many who would not listen. Many heard Christ, God's Son in person. They saw him raise people from the dead, perform great miracles, and yet they still nailed him to the cross. Was Christ then not a true preacher? Was he not preaching? Was he not then preaching the true gospel? Yet not everyone believed the word. Only a few repented and came to faith, it tells us. So this is how they reacted to Christ. Is it any wonder then that it was the experience of the apostles and ours as well today? The word is always pure and good, and by its very nature can do nothing but bear good fruit. The fact, because it does not always bear fruit everywhere, is not the fault of God or his word, but it is the fault of the soil that it is not good, because man's sinful hearts do not let the word remain, which makes it unproductive and decay. So the Lord is telling us in this parable to show us that it will always be this way with the gospel. Some will be converted, but others will take offense to the word. These hearers of the gospel had eyes that did not see and ears that did not understand. And finally, we should note how the Lord concludes this parable. He cries out loudly, "He who has ears, let him hear." So, brothers and sisters in Christ, listen to God's word while you have it. For there may come a time when we would like to hear it, but may not be able to. Therefore, give ear to God's word diligently while you have it. As the Lord says, "Walk while you have the light, lest darkness comes and takes it away." Amen. Please rise for the blessing. And now may the peace of God, which passes all our understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.
Thank you.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Please be seated for our next hymn. today. As far as the announcements, we have coffee and fellowship to follow. As you notice in your bulletins, there is the Bible study that we've been working through, and each time we'll review that as a review, or for some of you that haven't had the opportunity for Bible study, you certainly take that home and read what we've done there and talked about. So as far as we'll do that right after we get done with the announcements, and we'll review that. Also, we have the youth leaving for the winter youth retreat today at 2:30 from the church, or I could pick you up on the way. Please keep this in mind. It's still not too late to go to that. Tuesday, the sewing group, and Wednesday, confirmation at 5:30 and Bible study at 7. Next Sunday, then, we have Sunday school and regular worship with Lord's Supper, confirmation examination, and then the choir fundraiser. Please keep that in mind. It's a pancake dinner. There will be sausage, syrups, jellies, strawberries, whipped cream. We're also adding this year sausage over gravy and with gravy and biscuits, and then scrambled eggs. So please come hungry, and please eat after church for that. Also then, you see there that our Synod Board has called Pastor Nick Proach from East Grand Forks to consider being a faculty member, so keep him in your prayers. And then also, the lights were replaced in the fellowship hall, all the bulbs, so if anyone can use any of those bulbs, they're sitting in the hallway over here. Even if you want a whole box, there's more than what's there. Or if you want some of the new ones, there's some there too. You certainly can take some of them, but a small donation would be appreciated for that. Also, we note that in your prayers, to keep Sam Scullin in your prayers, because he had fell on the ice and had to have a surgery last week, so I don't know how he's doing. Irene disappeared here, I was going to ask her, but I keep him in your prayers as he heals patiently too. So in that order. Alright, so then we'll look at just shortly at this Bible study on the Christian funeral. And it's important for us to know this question: what is a Christian funeral? And for us to look at that and say, well, we must acknowledge that nowhere in Scripture it tells us about a Christian funeral or burial. It doesn't give us a form of service to use or a rite prescribed. And then, of course, there will be some of them that say, well, why should any church then have a right to deny a person a Christian funeral? Why certain hymns can't be sung, or why certain people shouldn't be allowed to take part in a service, such as a singer who's not from our church, or even times happens another pastor will be involved, or a hospice chaplain, or all kinds of crazy things that people come up with. And we know in our churches, as far as fellowship issues, we don't allow any other pastor to come here unless he's with our synod. So that's one important thing to keep in mind. But we must remember that a Christian funeral then becomes that when God's word is used, when Christian hymns are sung, when prayer, preaching, and all thanksgiving or thanks and praise are given to God, not to the person who has died. Okay? So the conservative Lutheran church, the heart of it is, of course, the words that are used at the committal service. Out of dust thou art come, unto dust thou shalt return, from dust thou shalt rise again. So the words of this committal service then are at the heart of a Christian funeral. They express God's word that talks about the hope of the resurrection. So important for us that the hope of the resurrection is there. Like Revelations 14:13 says, blessed are those who die in the Lord. If we look at the questions, then what is a Christian funeral? And as we went over that, that God's word is there, hymns, prayers, preaching. What is its meaning? And it expresses it, the person who passed away had the hope of the resurrection of life eternal. And then it becomes a sacred act when God's word is used in prayer. Now, over time, funeral practices have changed, and many today call what they call a funeral is a celebration of life. And it's interesting for us to think about this, because I'm sure you've heard it before. People call a funeral a celebration of life. They have much in common, yet they often appear very different. Each is a ceremony. It's a gathering of people that share a common loss. It's just one more, that the funeral is more rooted in tradition, while the other is a result of different changes in social values. So as you look down below, it says, what are your thoughts when you hear that statement, celebration of life? And I really didn't put anything on there. Then you can look at the next part, which says funeral versus celebration of life, and look at the difference. And if you go to that next page, it then says, what's the difference between celebration of life and a Christian funeral? And I'm going to read that whole section, but it says, a celebration of life tells the story of the deceased. It often gives honor and praise to them. It celebrates the achievement of the person who's died, and often can give credit to that person for the faith that they confess. And there's where it comes a problem. Of course, we don't say, I believed because it was something in my heart. It's because God put the Holy Spirit into me. His word strengthened me. That gave me the faith to believe. So there's a critical part there where it almost makes the person say that they're the one that believed and God just was there for them. So the difference then with a funeral, it follows a certain order of service. It gives all glory to God. It pronounces the hope of the resurrection. And it actually celebrates that God has now taken their child home to heaven. And so very important difference between celebration of life and a funeral. Are there any quick comments or questions, by the way? You can get the whole sheet in Bible study and make them available for people who don't get the Bibles. All right, if nothing else, then may God's precious word go with you throughout the week.